About a billion years ago, North America was facing imminent destruction. Vast tectonic forces were threatening to tear the continent apart, right through the middle. That didn't end up happening, so we still have a continent, which is cool. But that time of looming apocalypse did leave a lasting legacy, which would not only shape the geography of North America, but also the lives of its human inhabitants. So much so that for a time, around 9,000 years ago, one indigenous American culture used the remnants of this geologic upheaval to become the most technologically advanced in the world. To tell this incredible story, we're going to hand this episode over to our good friend, science communicator Alexis Dahl, who's reporting from Michigan, the one-time copper crucible of civilization. Take it away, Alexis.
Across the world and among different cultures, human technology has followed a pretty linear trajectory. We started out in the Stone Age, shaping axes, spear, and arrowheads out of stones like flint. Then, once we learned how to extract metals from the rocks that contained them, we started casting those metals into more effective tools, as well as protective armor. Civilization had entered the Bronze Age. Bronze is an alloy, which is a metal mixed with another substance. It's usually made from copper and tin, although you could swap the tin for arsenic. You shouldn't, but you technically could. This bronze alloy was the first to be harnessed by early cultures. And there are lots of copper-bearing rocks and minerals around. Green malachite, blue azurite, and golden chalcopyrite are all easy to spot and are good sources of copper. Tin is rarer, although it's likely that some of the first bronzes were accidentally created thanks to tin contamination in these copper ores. And in some places, archaeologists can identify a transitional copper age, or Chalcolithic, marking the very beginning of metalworking alongside more dominant stone tools. Around the world, different cultures figured out metalworking at different times, but the first metal tools typically date from 6,500 to 5,500 years ago. However, there is one unexpected civilization that bucks this trend. In North America, archaeologists have found that copper was being turned into tools some 9,500 years ago. That's 3,000 years before most other cultures had metalworking figured out. And we're not just talking about one or two pieces. Around Wisconsin and Michigan, tens of thousands of artifacts have been found belonging to the creatively named Old Copper Culture, an indigenous American culture that thrived around the Great Lakes for around 4,000 years. Why did this group leap forward in technology while the rest of the world lagged behind? The key lies in the geological events that laid the foundations for the Great Lakes themselves about 1 billion years ago. Around this time, North America was located on a continent called Laurentia, which was at the center of an even bigger supercontinent called Rodinia. Rodinia was still piecing itself together, and the eastern edge of Laurentia was colliding with another continent to begin to form the Appalachian Mountains. However, in the middle of the continent, the tectonic forces were reversed as the flowing mantle pulled the two halves of Laurentia apart from each other. The result was a huge rift in the crust, a lot like the East African Rift Valley today. Experts think that Africa will be split into two continents with an ocean in between within the next 10 million years. And that's what Laurentia was facing too. As the crust was torn apart, lava rose and flowed across the surface, and the existing rocks were fractured and filled with vast and complex hydrothermal systems fed by magma down below. This so-called mid-continent rift system stretched for about 2,000 kilometers across central Laurentia. And if it had reached the continent's edge, it would have eventually let in the sea and ripped America's west coast from the east for good. But for some reason, just as soon as the rift got started, it stopped. Perhaps the pressure from the growing Appalachian Mountains was too great, or perhaps the tectonic forces found an outlet somewhere else. But whatever the reason, America's mid-continent rift system failed to reach the sea. Instead, it left behind a U-shaped rift valley that's now filled by Lake Superior, as well as a band of igneous and hydrothermally altered rocks that stretches across the northern parts of Minnesota, Wisconsin, and Michigan. The volcanic fluids that penetrated these rocks carried and concentrated a bunch of minerals and metals, including copper. The thing is, although copper can certainly be found in the crust, it's a reactive metal. So it'll typically combine with other compounds like sulfur, oxygen, and carbonate if they're around. That's how we get those copper-containing minerals like malachite, chalcopyrite, cuprite, and azurite. So those were the raw materials that most civilizations had to work with when they embarked upon their metallurgy journey. But in the mid-continent rift system, things went differently. Here, the hot, copper-containing volcanic liquids wound their way through thick layers of volcanic rock. And there was nothing to react with that copper, leaving it all on its own. As the hydrothermal fluids cooled, the copper solidified as pure or native metal. Like this. Because of the unique conditions of the mid-continent rift, this region has become home to the largest deposit of native copper in the world. It was so abundant and so easy to find that the first humans in the area really couldn't have missed it. And so, with pure, unadulterated copper practically littering the ground around Lake Superior, the people of the old copper culture already had a head start on the rest of the world's metallurgists. But, of course, not everyone accepted this at face value. Some of the early researchers who found copper artifacts in this region straight up didn't believe that Native Americans could have produced them by themselves. They assumed that somehow Europeans had crossed the Atlantic thousands of years ago, shaped the tools, and then exported some of the copper back home. But the timelines, as well as the chemistry, reveal the true story. It's likely that the old copper culture people first found the copper nodules in glacial deposits, formed from the erosion of ancient rocks. Because these soft secondary deposits are loose and easy to dig through. They later delved directly into the source rocks themselves, with surface mining on Isle Royale and around the copper country here in Michigan. The ancient humans turned the copper they found into spearheads and arrowheads, as well as knives, axes, awls, and fish hooks through a combination of hammering, grinding, and molten casting. Researchers have used radioactive isotopes to figure out just how old these copper artifacts are. Dating of the wood and rope attached to spear points, as well as charcoal and bone found in copper culture burial sites, reveals a surprising trend. The old copper culture is really, really old. Isotopic evidence suggests that members of the old copper culture started extracting their metal as far back as 9,500 years ago. The oldest reliably dated artifact found to date is an 8,500-year-old spear point from Wisconsin. And much of the evidence clusters around dates from 7,000 to 5,000 years old. Researchers think this corresponds to the peak of the copper industry in this area. But then, something unexpected happened. Unlike other civilizations who made the move from stone to metal tools, the old copper culture didn't stick with their choice. It seems that they all but abandoned copper for practical objects by about 3,000 years ago, opting instead to use the metal for jewelry, like beads and bracelets, while switching back to stone for their tools. Which sounds absolutely wild. If you have metal tools, in what universe do you go back to the literal Stone Age? Some researchers have suggested that this unconventional shift came about as a result of social changes. Archaeological evidence shows that old copper culture populations were becoming larger, with more social hierarchy. This would have increased the demand for ornamental objects to reinforce that hierarchy. Thus, more copper was needed to make pretty things for copper culture elites, and less would have been available to make boring things, like tools. But this might not have been the only reason. An experimental study in 2019 revealed that, for all their apparent innovation, the old copper culture's copper tools actually weren't all that great. The scientists created their own copper and stone arrowheads from the same stuff as the ancients used, and then used them on soft plastic to simulate animal flesh. They found that the copper tools weren't any better than their stone equivalents, especially when considering the time taken to make them in the first place. Stone arrowheads started out sharper, and after being used for the same amount of time, became no blunter than their copper cousins. So maybe social demand for pretty copper came into play, but it was only possible because copper tools weren't great in the first place. But why should this be the case here in North America and not elsewhere? The answer may lie in the extraordinary purity of the copper in this area. This incredibly pure copper may have been something of a double-edged sword. These native copper nuggets were remarkable in forming without any other elements mixed in. So these North American metal workers wouldn't have needed to do anything other than heat them and reshape them. In contrast, other cultures experimenting with copper would have had to smelt their metal away from other compounds and impurities mixed in. This would have been an imperfect process, especially in primitive furnaces. So it's inevitable that some impurities would have remained in the finished metal. And in the case of metals like copper, impurities tend to make a metal stronger. That's basically the whole idea behind alloys. You can imagine a pure metal as being made of balls that are all the same size. If you apply a force, those layers of balls can easily slide over one another. But if you mix in other elements, it's equivalent to throwing in a handful of larger balls. They'll catch and snag your sliding layers, making them less likely to move and making the resultant metal more rigid. Ultimately, that's why the first really successful metal age was the Bronze Age, since the intentional alloying of two softer metals, copper and tin, made something that was stronger and more useful. But even before that, civilizations were accidentally alloying their copper by not fully purifying it. However, here, around Lake Superior, the copper was already pure, and therefore, soft. Too soft, it seemed, to survive in the long run. The remarkable copper nuggets ended up being a curse in disguise. They may have been easy to find and work, but they make terrible tools. And there just wasn't any motivating force for the old copper culture to develop smelting technology to move on to bronze. These people developed remarkable technology in the context that they lived in. It's not really their fault that they hit a dead end. Despite the eventual disappearance of the old copper culture, the legacy of these rare mineral deposits has lived on. Starting in the mid-1800s, a wave of miners immigrated to the copper country from places like England, Finland, and Canada, extracting millions of tons of metal in the first mineral rush in United States history. And it's a heritage people around here take very seriously. I mean, there's Copper Island, Copper Harbor, and of course, the copper country as a whole. It's a whole thing. And it's all thanks to a fledgling rip in the center of an ancient continent. I have loved telling you about this nugget of Michigan history. Savannah, tell the people at home how they can get some copper.
I will tell them. If you want to become a Rocks Box subscriber or just learn more, you can head over to scishow.rocks or use the link in the description. If you're not into a monthly shipment, don't worry. We also have a selection of specimens a la minecart too. Also, thanks Alexis for showing us around Michigan's copper country. You can find her here on YouTube using the other link in the description.